exceeding proud. Now there's an old saying that says that Fortran programmer can write Fortran program in any language. And that's quite often what we do. We write C in Go. Many of us do, and I have been doing it for quite a while. I've been trying to cure myself, but I'm still doing it sometimes. So in his very good book, High Order Perl, Mark Gelandominus says that we're writing C programs in Perl, and this is really pity, because Perl is much, much more expressive than C, and we can do many, many things that a C programmer wouldn't even dream of. Perl has a lot of concepts which are borrowed from the functional programming, especially this as far as Perl 5 is concerned, Haskell as far as Perl 6 is concerned, and that allows us to make programs which are shorter, more expressive, more efficient, maybe not more efficient in terms of speed, but more efficient in terms of how quickly we write the program. And yeah, we can even say that Perl is semantically closer to Lisp than to C, even though the syntax is probably closer to C. So, what? Now, when Mark Gelandominus was writing that, he was thinking about Perl 5. And his book has really changed my way of coding. I'm really a different person since I read this book. And not only Perl. But now what I want to do is applying the same idea of high order Perl to Perl 6. Now I have only 45 minutes, so I'm not going to do everything that Mark Gelandominus does in his 450 or 500 page book. I will only make a very small subset of it. Now, as I said at the beginning, a lot of what I will be showing applies to Perl 5 and Perl 6. Sometimes the syntax will be, well, the syntax will be Perl 6, but sometimes you can just change one or two small things and have exactly the same thing in Perl 5. And then there are a few things which are new to Perl 6, because Perl 6 has more programming, functional programming features than Perl 5 has. So what is functional programming? It's very difficult to say. I mean, every person you ask a question will have a different answer. So because of that, I will just give some answers. None of them is sufficient to say what functional programming is. If you take them together, I think you get a pretty good idea. So functional programming is a programming paradigm that treats computation as the evaluation of mathematical function. That is, you use an expression, you don't use a statement, essentially. You use an expression, it returns your value. And whenever you try again the same function with the same parameters, you're supposed to get the same results. So we're doing that with expression rather than statements or instructions. As I said, the output value of a subroutine is supposed to be always the same. There are exceptions, like the rank subroutine or things like that. There isn't supposed to be any side effect, except maybe printing things to the screen and this type of thing. And functional programming is about stateless program. Immutable values. Don't use variables, you use constants, right? Symbolic computation. And then there are a lot of things here. It's just a list of things that you find in the functional programming. High order functions, list processing, pipeline processing, iterators, anonymous functions, lambdas, closures, etc. So we'll just see just a few of them. List operators. So many Perl operators work on list or produce lists. But here I've named quite a few of them. As you can see, most of them you find in Perl 5, join, split, print, save if you use a feature, sort, for, map, grep, all these It is in Bonfire. And then there are a few more which I have been there. There are many more than that, but a few more which are specific to Bonfire, like Comp, Reduce, Gather and Take, and then there's a whole series of meta operators and item operators. So the great thing about this processor, this processing, this operator, is that they can be chained to create the data pipeline so that they can create a pipeline where each step is doing incremental changes to the data. So here I've just given four examples of ways to find even number which are smaller than 15. The first two, well, the first one used map and join and the range operator. This one you can just use it exactly like that in Perl 5, except that you have to remove the comma after the closing brace. Otherwise, it's just about the same. The grep, the second one, the grep, is also almost the same in Perl 5. You also have to remove the comma and then you have a new operator here, %, but you can replace that with %, 2, equal 0, and you get the same result. Then in Perl 6, the third one is in Perl 6. Here, it's just doing the same thing, but with a syntax which goes the other way around, from left to right instead of right to left. This is called the feed operator. So it's just doing the same thing, but the other way around. It is supposed to, I don't think it's implemented yet in Rakuido, but if you're using this operator, it is supposed to be possible one day to have the various parts operate on different CPU or different cores of the same CPU, so it auto-parallelizes the processing. I don't think it's implemented yet. At least it wasn't implemented a year ago when I looked in detail. I don't think it has been implemented since. You can also use a chain of methods instead of a chain of functions. It works more or less the same way. This is the last example. Now, functions like map and grep are very interesting, and sort also, because they use a cobloc as a parameter, or a subroutine as a parameter, to define what they do to the data. Basically, let's say map doesn't do very much, it just takes every piece of data and applies something to it. Now the interesting thing is the something, because this is a function that we pass as a parameter to map, and it can be any function that you can, or actually a function or an operation. So map and grep in that sense are just generic functions, abstract functions. The real interesting part is what you pass as a first argument to them. So now, when a cobloc and a subroutine can be a parameter or a return value for another subroutine or another function, we speak about higher order functions, or sometimes you also use the word first class functions. And now, why would you want to use higher order functions? So here I have a small example of a little piece of code to browse the directory tree and print the name of the files that it finds in the directory tree. This is Perl 6 syntax, but you could just do almost the same thing in Perl 5, just having to change the syntax for the for loop and a couple of other things, but it's basically, you can do exactly the same. So what it does here in the for loop, it looks at every entry that is finding in the directory. If the entry is a file, then you print the file. If the entry is a directory, then you recurse. You call the same function on the directory in order to go to the next step into the tree. This is really fine, but now if I want to find the total size of my file, I just have to rewrite the whole subroutine again, because it's not aimed at doing that, it's just aimed at printing the files. Now if I want to delete the PMP file, I have to rewrite the subroutine again, If I want to archive all the files, same thing. And that's bad. We want to reuse those. And that's why IO function are useful. Because what we can do here, we have another version of this called the Traverse Deer subroutine, version number 2. And what we do here, if you look at the parameter, we're passing 2 parameters. Before we had only 1, the path. Now we have 2 parameters, a codref and a path. And why do we do that? Because then we can use a codref on the entry. If the entry is a file. And what's this codref? Well, it's the line before the last on my screen, the sub print file, and it's just take an argument, which is a file, and print it, and print the file. And now on the last line, I'm calling traverse deer, and I'm passing out an argument, print file, or reference to print file, and the path where I want to do the thing. And so now, I no longer have to change traverse deer if I want to do something else with it, because I can pass as an argument, as the first argument to traverse deer, I can pass a function, like print file in that case. Or in that other case, I'm passing a code block, which is just computing the total size of the files. So print file or whatever I'm passing as an argument in this one, is usually called the callback. And that's why we can use now traverse deer to measure the size occupied by the files on the directory tree, or to do any other things, to archive all the files, to delete 10 files, and so on. So anonymous subroutines, the callback function, that the one we've seen, can be named. This is what we have in the first example of traverse deer 2. And this is what we have here. We're defining on the second line of the code a grid subroutine. And the grid subroutine just say hello world. And then we're defining a do twice subroutine, which is just calling its argument twice. The argument is a function, it's calling twice. And then I do twice grid, and I'm just going to print hello world twice. Callback functions can also be anonymous subroutine. So here, instead of defining a grid subroutine, I'm just defining an anonymous subroutine, say hello world, and storing it into a variable called grid2. Then I do twice grid2, and I get the same result. Print hello world twice. I can even pass the subroutine directly without giving it even a variable name. This is what we have in the third example. Do twice, sub, say hello world. And that will do the same thing as before. And in this case, the subroutine is very simple because it doesn't have any argument. So I can even use a bare block instead of using a sub. So do twice, open curly, say hello world, close curly, and that will do the same thing as before. And let's see. Yeah, it's just here another example with a code block, reduce. So this example was there because in this case we have 2 arguments, and we are able nonetheless to use the 2 arguments because dollar caret A and dollar caret B are positional parameters. So even though I haven't any signature, I can use them as parameters for my code block. I think I made a mistake here. This is the same that you have already seen. Lambdas. What are lambdas? The reduce example which we have here is actually a lambda. A lambda is just a nameless function, or if you want an anonymous function. So here's another example of a lambda. Dot say for map, dot tc, and then a list of European capitals, and each of the capitals will be printed with a capital, with the initial capital letter. This is also a lambda because there is no, it's a function which has no name. Here's another example of a lambda, which is somewhat similar to what we've seen before. My even numbers, my Auerbach evens equals grep, and then you take numbers from 1 to 17, and you, and among them you pick only those which are even, those which are evenly divided by 2. The pointy block syntax, which I used twice here for this, for displaying the multiplication table, is also lambda. So what we do here is for 1 to 9, and then we declare an argument called mult. Say the multiplication table for that argument is, and then a nested for 1 to 9 var, and then we print mult times var equal mult times var. So this is also a lambda. Clojures is another keyword for functional programming. The clojure is a function that can access the lexical variables that were available to it when it was defined. So here I have an example. Subtract counter. I get a parameter per count, and then I just, for various reasons, create a new variable called counter, which I set equal to the parameters I have received, count. And then I create a small sub called increment count, in which only returns counter and then increments counter. And at the end, I return this subroutine which I have just written. And that will work, and will print. If I do count from 5 and pass number 5, and then call this function 6 times, it will print the number from 5 to 10. Now, I made it a little bit more complicated than it needs to be. The reason for it is I wanted to give a number to the sub I was creating. This increment count subroutine has a name. And the reason I wanted to do that is because many people think that clojure have to be an anonymous subroutine. I just wanted to show that it can be actually a named subroutine. Having said that, I must say that usually you use it with an anonymous subroutine. As I said, the example was a little bit contrived because I wanted to show a name closure, but closures don't need to be named, and are generally anonymous. Now, the interesting thing about closure is that it's possible to create functions dynamically at runtime. So here's an example, which is a little bit more code. So I just have more or less the same thing as before, but with an anonymous closure this time. So this create counter function creates the function at runtime. And then I call it, what is it, two times. I first call it with number 5, and then I call it with number 10, and I give a different name to the dynamically created subroutine that I receive. One is count from 5, and the other one count from 10. And what happens here is that I really have two different subroutines, both created by the same create counter, and they can work in parallel without mixing one with each other. So I count from 5, for instance, we count from 5 to 10 here, and then I count, then I call count from 10, and we will start by 10, 11, and 12. So what we have done here with the same one subroutine creating several functions, we've created a function factory. And we can create as many counter functions as we need just by calling the create counter. And this can be used with even dispatch table. As an example, I just created a function factory for the alphabet. So what I want to do is to split a file containing a list of words into 26 files, one file for each letter of the alphabet. So I'm just creating one function, createSub, which will see the one letter of the alphabet as a parameter, and it will create a file. It will open a file with that letter. The file will be letter underscore and the letter, and return a sub. And then what I do is I loop from A to Z for each letter, and I just create 26 functions that will. I'm creating a dispatch table of with 26 letter, each letter, for each letter of the value in this hash is the function. So this is good and fine. This example I used on a list of 118,000 words, which is a list of all the words accepted for crossword puzzles and other things, and I put dispatch everything into 26 files. In some cases, maybe you don't want to create all the files at the beginning, because maybe some you will not need. If your list is not 113,000, as my list, if your list has 10 words, you probably don't want to create 26 files if you're going to use only a small part of it. So you can also do it dynamically, which is what I have done here. Here it's just, I have a list of four words: Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, Zulu, and I want to put them in different files. But I don't want to create a file for letter D or for letter F, because there is no word starting with letter D or letter F. So I'm just creating the function dynamically when I need it. So if I see the first letter of a word, which is A, I first check that if I have already a function for a word starting with letter A. If I don't, I create it. If it's created, then I get it, and that's it. The interesting thing is that it shows that it's really dynamically created when I need it. If I don't need it, if I never need a function for letter H, then I will not create a file for that, and I will not create a function for that. Iterators. Suppose I want to create a function like map, but that would process it one item at a time when the consumer process wants to happen. I can start by building an iterator with a closure. So create iterator, and then I'm just using an index, which is incremented this time I'm using it. And then I use it as follows: sub enter map, and I return the color ref. So this thing is, so it's like map, but it's doing one at a time, whenever I need one. And the reason for doing that, that's very interesting, is because I can then use the iterator on infinite list. So here, the first code line says, my iterator is create iter one dot dot star. That means I'm really creating an iterator from one to infinity. And it works because Perl is not going to create an infinite list, because that would be quite bad. But it will just prepare it so that when I'm using iter map before, it will just pick one element, one item at a time. And it will continue to do so for a very long period. The code that I have shown with just very minor change would work in Perl 5. Like here, The one thing that we need to change is to remove the comma after the closing brace. And then you don't have a star operator for infinity, but you could presumably put a very large number. Perl 6 has a sequence operator, three dots, which allows to create lists in a more diversified way. So my example is how to create a list of even numbers. Well, what you do is you stamp a list with two values, then you put a three dot operator, the sequence operator, and you let it go to infinity. And because we look at that, we'll see that the first value is zero, the second value is two, and we'll figure out that the next value should probably be four, and then six, and so on. Another thing you can do is if you're providing three values instead of two for the starting of the list, and here my geometric progression equals 1, 2, 4, dot, 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 32. The problem is look at that and see, oh, 1, 2, 2, 4, looks like a geometric progression, so the next number should probably be 8, and then 16, 32, and so on. So we create a list in the geometric progression. And you can also, so all this is interesting, but not all interesting lists are arithmetic progression or geometric progression. So you can create other lists by using a generator in the dot 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 construct. So here, for example, I'm generating my first element in my list is one. Then what I'm doing is a cut block, which is the next element should be that one plus two, and the next element should be that three plus two. And I let it go to 11, and that makes another way of making an arithmetic progression. And then the last example here is we can also use it to create an infinite list of Fibonacci number. For example, what I'm just doing is the first number will be 0, and the second number will be 1, and then given two numbers before, the next number will be the sum of the two numbers before. That's what $A, $B, and the cut block do. And that will create my Fibonacci list. Carrying, this is another basic technique of functional programming. The example there, make add, takes a numeric value as parameter and then returns a sub which will add the numeric value that I've got with the new parameter that I get. So the example here is my add 2 equals make add 2, so I'm passing 2 as a parameter. So, and then when I use add 2 and I pass 3, it will add 2 to 3 and give me 5. This you can also do in Perl 5. Now, this is another construction doing the same thing and a little bit more than that, and that is specific in Perl 6, using the assuming method. I first create a normal function add, this is just for the example, which takes two parameters and returns some of the two parameters. That's just, and then now this is just for having something to work on. And then I'm saying my add 2 equals add, the function that I just created, supposing I just created, and I say assuming 2. And the fact that, so this method called assuming 2 will tell Perl that add 2 will be using two parameters, but one of the parameters is the one provided by assuming 2. And the other parameter will be the one that we'll be passing to. So if I do add 2, 5, I will get 7 points. Because I get 5 and then I have 2 which was passed by the dot assuming 2 method invocation. And we want the same thing here. I can add 4, and if I call it with 5, I get 9. Now you can also use another way of using the weather operator. Which is using the star operator or the whatever operator. The whatever operator is a placeholder order for an argument, and the expression returns a closure. So the example here, I say my third equals star over three, and Perl will know that now if I call third with some value, it will have to divide that some value by three. So if I call it with 126, I get 42. I hope the math is correct. So the star operator is somewhat similar to the dollar underscore operator that we know. It has some similarity, but it's doing more things. And one of the things that is good about it, you can use it even if it's not declared, which is not possible. It's not what I want to say. It doesn't need to exist when you make the declaration. Whereas if you do that with dollar underscore, it will not work. Now all of these which I have shown are just techniques from the functional programming, but which are useful. You can make many useful things, many explosive things with it. But I would like to bring it a little bit further. Not just some examples of useful techniques, but you could really go one step further and try to use a real functional programming style. This is not adapted to every problem, but there are many that will benefit and make your code much more expressive. Now, the example is the merge sort algorithm. Everybody knows what the merge sort algorithm is. You know, you have a list of numbers. Your function receives a list of numbers. You just split the list in two halves, and then you call the same function on each of the two half lists. And then when you get the result back, you just merge what you just received from your function. That's about it. It's very simple. Was invented in 1950 by John von Neumann. So this is a non-functional or procedural version of the merge sort algorithm. I will not go further on it. I will just go straight to the functional implementation of the same. So not only is the code about twice shorter, that's not very important, but these two examples I wrote when I was writing this book, which by the way is available at Wendy. And when I wrote that, it took me 2.5 hours to get it right. I had off by one errors, I had other errors, and it took me 2.5 hours. So that's about 150 minutes. This version took me 15 minutes. 10 times less. And it was right the first time. I mean, there was maybe a syntax mistake. I just corrected it and then it worked. So that's a big difference between functional programming and procedural programming. I really spent 10 times less writing this. So not only is the code shorter, it is a bit shorter, but also if you look at it, it captures the sense of the merge sort algorithm much better. You look at the merge sort function. If the list it receives is only one item, then it's the list is already sorted, it just returns it. If it's more than that, then you just split the list into elements. You look for the more or less the middle of the list. And then you just call merge sort on the first list and on the second list. And then after that, you merge the two lists that you receive in return, and that's it. So it's very simple. It actually captures exactly what I said in the beginning, how the merge sort works. If you look at that, sorry, it's much more difficult to see that what it actually does. You really have to work your way through. Now, another example is the quicksort algorithm. Everyone knows, of course, what's the difference between merge-sort and quicksort, right? Well, quicksort acts in basically the same principle as merge-sort. Instead of just dividing your list in two parts, you just take one element from the list, and you say, I will split that list in two different lists, one with all the elements which are smaller than the one that I have picked, and one with all the elements which are larger than that. This element is equal to pivot. So basically, you take a list, you just pick, for example, the first number, and then in this list, you just look for all the elements smaller, all the elements bigger, and you call some quicksort on it. Now, I won't go further on that, but notice that to be able to show the code, the non-functional implementation of quicksort, I had to reduce the font quite significantly. I don't know if everyone can see this from the back, but it's much smaller than the other code examples I have. Now, let's look at the functional programming implementation. Seven lines if you count the closing brace. So, same thing. I don't remember how much time I spent on each of them, but it's so much faster to write that than to write the other one. It gives you an idea. Now, and also, just as before, if you look at it, it's very easy to see what the algorithm does. I mean, it really captures the essence of it. What you do is, if your list has less than one element, you return it. One element or less, you return it. If not, you choose a pivot, which is any number, any element within the list. And then you just return with a grep. I won't go further on it. So the code is 3 times shorter. The functional code captures very neatly the essence of the algorithm. Now, there is a small problem with that, is that the functional programming version copies data many times over instead of doing in-place sorting. So if you're going to sort a very big list, the first implementation will probably be faster. So you have to know that. On the other hand, because we're not changing data in functional programming, you can it's much easier to run it in parallel on several CPUs or several cores of one CPU. Now, quicksort algorithm once again, but the example I showed before were really scalar-like. Now I want to show it in Haskell. And the interesting thing about the Haskell code which you have there is that this is used by the Haskell fans as the showcase to show the show window to show how good Haskell is. You see, we are able to implement quicksort in 6 lines. That's what they say all the time. This is really the example they use. Now, if I do it in Perl 6, it's just also 6 lines. Actually, it's a bit less code if you count the characters. So. Yeah, I think I don't have too much time still, so... I will just show one more thing. I was just talking about this functional programming, non-functional programming, the speed with a large list. And so I did a third case, which is running it using parallelism, using concurrency. So using actually 8 cores of my computer, and then I computed I made it 10 times with 1,000 value. So you will see the result is a non-functional version is faster. It runs in 1,300ths of a second. The functional version is about 2.5 times slower, so you have to take that into account. Functional programming is very useful, but if you really have very severe performance constraint, you have to be careful. And then I also tried the parallel version, and the parallel version is just slightly slower than the non-functional version, but maybe more or less than that. So it's interesting. Now, okay. Well, I hope I have convinced you to use functional programming, but if you have any questions, please ask them. No question? Okay, well, thank you. Just additional readings. The book I mentioned at the beginning, Higher Order Perl by Mark Chisholm Dominus. It's available online, but I would suggest if you're interested with it, then you probably want to buy the paper copy. That's at least what I did. I first read it online. It's a bit difficult. It's not easy reading, you know. So I ended up buying the book, and I think it's a good thing to do. Then this book, which is a very good book, which you can get from Wendy at a very low price. The last chapter is on functional programming in Perl, so you can take a look at this. And these slides are available on my GitHub site. You can reuse them if you want to, save them, do whatever you want with it. It's just a share license. Thank you.